outstretched arm. His love endures forever. And for the life that has been reborn, his love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise. Sing praise, sing praise. Forever God is faithful. Forever God is strong. Forever God is with us. Forever, forever, forever God is faithful. Forever God is strong. Forever God is with us. Forever, forever, forever. From the rising to the setting sun, God, we will carry on. His love endures forever. Sing praise, sing praise, sing praise, sing praise. Forever God is faithful. Forever God is strong. Make sure to declare his goodness with your instrument. God has given you an instrument of praise. And do you know that the scripture backs up that song with Psalm 136, verse 1. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His faithful love endures forever. Hallelujah. Tell the person next to you, God is faithful and he loves you. The scripture says that we should praise him with our voices and with the 10-stringed instrument. I know a banjo isn't 10 strings. But do you know what? Some of you feel like, I don't have a voice that is good enough to sing and praise. I wouldn't stand in front of a mic. Well, I wouldn't either. All right? But nothing is going to keep me from declaring how good my God is. While I have breath in my body, I will declare and make joyful noise of declaring who God is. And don't wait for heaven to make a shouting noise. This may not have 10 strings, but it makes a noise. And this noise is okay with God. He says we're supposed to praise him with the harp. I don't have a harp, or maybe I do. But I will let this instrument that usually plays the blues sing something happy, good news.
There is power.
given you a word. Speak it out. Well, the Lord did give me a word in the night. How do we commune with God? How do we commune with one we cannot see? We fellowship or meet with God by intentionally setting our thoughts on Him and expressing our feelings of love and gratitude to the one who made us. These times of meditation on Him are sweet and refreshing, like water to a thirsty soul. My soul longs for you, O God. Like the deer pants for the water brook, so my soul longs for you, O God. Oh, when will I appear before you, O God? You see me, I don't see you. Like a flower in the middle of a desert place, I need water from your hand to grow. Yes, I will rejoice in the Lord. And as those words swarmed my dreams early morning, and I woke up rehearsing all the scripture verses that came like a flood, like a gushing fountain, a refreshing rain or flowing into my dry and needy soul. I was looked in the scriptures, where, oh Lord, does it say that meditating on you is like sweet refreshment to my soul? And said in Psalm 104, 1 and 33 and 34, bless the Lord, O my soul. That's a choice. O Lord, my God, you are very great. You are clothed in honor and majesty. I will sing to the Lord as long as I live, and I will sing praises to my God while I have my being, while I exist. My meditation of Him will be sweet. I will be glad in the Lord. I will be glad in the Lord. I planned on doing an old song this week that has some of these words in it. And the scripture verse, as I was preparing the song list, my wife said, this is the song that I wanted you to sing. And it was the same old song. I love when confirmation comes. Hallelujah.
Sing praises to Thee among the nations, for Thy steadfast love is great to the heavens, and Thy faithfulness to the clouds. Exalted, O God, above the heavens, let Thy glory be over all the earth. Be exalted, O God, above the heavens. All the earth.
you, Lord. We worship you, Lord. Worship you, O King. Jesus, 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 we love you. We worship you, Lord. Hallelujah, Lord. Hallelujah, Lord.
Generations falling down in worship to sing the song of ages to the Lamb, and all have gone before us, and all who will believe will sing the song of ages to the Lamb. Your name is the highest. Your name is the greatest. Your name stands above them all. All thrones and dominions, all powers and positions, your name stands above them all. And the angels cry, holy, all creation cry.
You're struggling with the burden that tries to steal your peace. If the things in front of you in the natural are causing you to lose heart, look up. Your redemption draws nigh, and the King is still on the throne. He sees you. He is for you. He will give you strength for the battle. He will give you peace for the day. He will give you sleep in the night. And he will give you power for the fight. You are his children. You, the Lord, has set his eyes upon and has called you here to give you a word of comfort today. A word that says, be gone everything that exalts itself against the name of the Lord. When the Lord shows up, his enemies flee. When the enemy rises up, the Lord stands by us. Hallelujah, hallelujah.
Good morning, church. I have two stories for you this morning. So settle in. Usually a sermon is just one story. They always say you got to have 3 points to a sermon, and we say you should have 1 point to a sermon, because that's all people can remember. That's all I can remember, anyway. But we're going to go with two stories this morning, and because they're related, and it's a very important topic I want to talk to you about, which is answers to prayer and being disappointed sometimes by God, and how do you handle that? And the first story, we start out in 2 Kings, and it's ultimately it's going to be about Manasseh, which is one of the kings of Israel, and Manasseh was the worst king that Judah ever had. I don't know if he was the worst king. Israel may have had worse kings, but Manasseh was the longest serving and the worst king that Judah ever had. And his story starts a generation earlier with Hezekiah, which is his father. Hezekiah was an amazing king. He was the greatest king since David. In fact, he celebrated a Passover. I think it was 100,000 sheep that were sacrificed. He said it was the greatest Passover that had been observed since David, King David. He was an awesome king. He had had this amazing victory where the whole city, the whole nation of Judah was destroyed pretty much, except for the city of Jerusalem, which was under siege by the king of Assyria. And he just took that accusation from the king of Assyria, and he laid it before God's altar. He said, God, we can't do anything about this. We need your help. We lay this before you, God. And God answered his prayer, sent the angel of death out there, the angel of the Lord, and killed 175,000 Assyrians in one night and delivered the city of Jerusalem. God used Hezekiah for some pretty amazing things. And he was also a very powerful king, wealthy. And we pick up his story in 2 Kings chapter 20, verses 1 through 7. In those days, immediately following that amazing victory that God used Hezekiah, he became ill and was at the point of death. And the prophet Isaiah, the son of Amoz, went to him and said, this is what the Lord says, put your house in order because you're going to die. You will not recover. You think of that, at the peak of your achievement, this is the prime of life. Hezekiah was 40 years old at the time, and he's sick and he's dying. And because he feels like he's going to die, and here comes a prophet. Don't you often think, okay, if I'm sick, I'm going to call for the elders, they'll lay hands on me and heal me. Here comes the prophet, and he says, you're going to die. Hezekiah was very discouraged about that. He turned his face to the wall. He prayed to the Lord, remember, Lord, how I have walked before you faithfully and with wholehearted devotion and have done what is good in your eyes. And Hezekiah wept bitterly. He mourned because he felt that he was achieving what God wanted. He was God's servant. He was God's tool. What was God going to do without him? Hezekiah was so important to God's plans. And don't we feel that way sometimes when we see somebody cut down in the prime of life? Feel like, what are they missing? What else could God have used them to do? When I think of my dad, and I think of his children and grandchildren following after the Lord, and the things that he's missing in God, and how Scripture says I have no greater joy than to know that my children are walking in the truth, and to think that he's missing that, the greatest joy in life is to see that your legacy bear fruit for God's kingdom. And he's missing all that. And you can see, I believe that's one of the things that Hezekiah was mourning. See, I've achieved all these things. I worked so hard to accomplish your will, God, and I'm being cut down right now. I don't get to enjoy any of it. What more could I accomplish for you, God? And he wept bitterly. I don't think Hezekiah's attitude in this was correct. I think he was discouraged. Instead of turning his face toward God, instead of looking at the people that he needs to minister to, his family. I mean, he was told to put your affairs in order, which means go talk to your children, talk to your wife, talk to the ministers in the kingdom and say, this is what has to happen after I die. And instead, he got depressed, very discouraged, which is an understandable thing. I'm not holding you to the highest standard to say, when God says you're going to die, you say, awesome, that's wonderful. Thank you, Lord. I realize that's a difficult thing to do. But Hezekiah was not very happy about this news. But God did not leave him in that position very long. Before Isaiah had left the middle court, the word of the Lord came to him. Go back and tell Hezekiah, the ruler of my people, this is what the Lord, the God of your father David, says. I have heard your prayer and seen your tears, and I will heal you. On the third day from now, you will go up to the temple of the Lord. This is what we pray for people. This is our passion, that when they're sick, that they'll be healed. We love stories like this, that God was kind to Hezekiah, that God healed him. And God said, I will add 15 years to your life. Isn't this interesting? This is the second time now that God has told him when he's going to die. So now Hezekiah knows that he's going to be healed, and 15 years later, he's going to die. I mean, how do you think he spent the next 15 years? Saying, I know exactly, he was going to die at 55 years old. He knew that. That's kind of an interesting way to go through life, isn't it? I don't know of anyone else that God told, you're going to die at this time. He told that to Hezekiah twice. I will deliver you and this city from the hand of the king of Assyria, because Assyria was still a huge empire at the time. And I will defend this city for my sake and for the sake of my servant David. Then Isaiah said, prepare a poultice of figs, and they did so, and applied it to the boil, and he recovered. Oh, so Hezekiah was dying from a boil. That sounds pretty nasty. This is a big boil. Doc, I won't ask you to describe how that would happen, how a person happens to die from a boil. So he recovered, and we've always looked at the healing of Hezekiah as a wonderful thing. It's a kind thing that God did for Hezekiah, and it was. However, there's more to this story. Obviously, it wasn't the end of his life. There were 15 years more to his life, and what did he do with those 15 years? Now, we're going to jump over to 2 Chronicles for this. And if you've ever been reading through the Bible, you're like, you got 1st, 2nd Samuel, 1st, 2nd Kings, 1st, 2nd Chronicles, and you're seeing stories pop up. Again, haven't I read this before? It gets kind of confusing. And this helps me a lot. You got 1st Samuel kind of stands alone, but 2nd Samuel is repeated in 1st Chronicles. And then you got 1st and 2nd Kings, and they are repeated in 2nd Chronicles. So that's why you see some of these stories over and over again, because there is some overlap there. And that's very close to how those books line up. So we can skip over to 1 Chronicles, to 2 Chronicles, and we're going to see some of the rest of Hezekiah's story. It's much more brief because you got to fit two books into one, and actually most of 2 Chronicles is talking about Solomon and the temple. So actually all the rest of the kings of Judah are very, very truncated, very limited. So Hezekiah's story is told pretty quickly, but sometimes you see some extra things that are put in there. Chapter 32, verses 24 through 26. In those days, Hezekiah became mortally ill, and he prayed to the Lord, and the Lord spoke to him and gave him a sign. We got that part already. But Hezekiah gave no return for the benefit he received, because his heart was proud. So this happened when, at some point, God restored the whole kingdom of Judah to him, and his wealth and his power, and there were some emissaries came from the nation of Babylon, and Hezekiah was actually showing off to them, because Babylon was not an empire at the time. They'd never even heard of Babylon before. This is them introducing themselves to the world. They send all these emissaries out, and Hezekiah's like, I'm going to show these little pups what a real king looks like. So we took him and showed him all his treasuries, and was demonstrating his power and his glory to these emissaries from Babylon. And what ended up happening was Isaiah, again, was sent to Hezekiah, and he said, "You fool. All the things that you showed those emissaries from Babylon, all the things that your fathers and your forefathers and David and Solomon amassed and is still wealth here in Jerusalem, that same empire is going to carry away because of your pride. Therefore, wrath came on him and on Judah and on Jerusalem. However, Hezekiah humbled the pride of his heart, both he and the inhabitants of Jerusalem, so that the wrath of the Lord did not come on them in the days of Hezekiah." And he was actually told, "This isn't going to happen in your time, it'll happen in your descendants' time." And Hezekiah again kind of blew it, and he said, "Oh, that's fine, it's not going to be my problem to deal with, it'll be someone else's problem. I'll be dead before that happens. I know 15 years after that, it's not my problem." Hezekiah did not use those 15 years well. And then comes the really heartbreaking part. 2 Kings, after Hezekiah is gone, 2 Kings picks up, chapter 21, verses 1 and 2. Manasseh was 12 years old when he became king. And that just cuts me every time. Manasseh would never have been born had Hezekiah died the first time. When he begged for life, he bitterly argued with God, turned his face to the wall, said, "God, you need me. I am awesome. I have done all these amazing things for you." And God answered his prayer, but it wasn't necessarily a good thing for the nation of Judah. Now, God had his own purposes in answering Hezekiah's prayer. And we got to believe, we got to trust that God knew what he was doing, even though us looking back, we'd say it would have been better for that prayer to not been answered. It would have been better for Hezekiah to die at that time. Because Manasseh reigned 55 years in Jerusalem. His mother's name was Hephzibah, and he did evil in the sight of the Lord, according to the abominations of the nations whom the Lord dispossessed before the sons of Israel. Manasseh was the worst king and the longest reigning king in Judah's history, and he never would have been born. You ready for the second story? Second story is about David and Jonathan. This is the great friendship story in the Bible. These guys were mighty warriors, David and Jonathan both. They had awesome reputations for what they could accomplish for God. And they were the power couple. They were the team that drove the kingdom that God used to accomplish so many awesome things. And I want to go through just a few illustrations of the friendship that was between David and Jonathan throughout their careers. We first are introduced to this right after David is used to slay Goliath in 1 Samuel 18, verses 1 through 4. It came about when he finished speaking to Saul that the soul of Jonathan was knit to the soul of David, and Jonathan loved him as himself. You would think that David and Jonathan would have run into each other, and they probably did. But after Jonathan saw David's valor, then he saw this is a person just like me, because Jonathan had been used by God in some pretty amazing battles already. Jonathan was seized by the Spirit of God. He was an awesome warrior. And when he sees the same thing in David, the soul of Jonathan is knit to the soul of David. And Jonathan loved him as himself. Saul took him that day and did not let him return to his father's house. That's David. Then Jonathan made a covenant with David because he loved him as himself. Jonathan stripped himself of the robe that was on him and gave it to David with his armor, including his sword and his belt and his bow. And this is significant because Jonathan is demonstrating by taking his robe. This is a royal robe. He's the prince. And you're in that culture, your clothes designate who you are, what your office is, your station. And he took his robe and he gave it to David, saying, "I'm not the prince. You're the prince now." And this sword, there was a time when only Saul and Jonathan had swords. There was a battle. And all the nation of Israel, there was only two swords, Saul and Jonathan. And God used Jonathan and his sword to bring about an amazing victory, almost single-handedly. And then Jonathan gives this sword to David. This is a pretty significant event. Later on, after David has gotten on the wrong side of Saul, 1 Samuel 20, verses 15 through 17, Jonathan meets David again after David is beginning to run away from Saul. He's being afflicted, and Jonathan meets him and begs him, "You shall not cut off your loving kindness from my house forever." Not even when the Lord cuts off every one of the enemies of David from the face of the earth. And he's talking about his own house. He's talking about his father Saul is David's enemy. And even when God has gotten rid of all of your enemies, remember my house. So Jonathan made a covenant with the house of David, saying, may the Lord require it at the hands of David's enemies. Jonathan made David vow again because of his love for him, because he loved him as he loved his own life. And then Saul learned about Jonathan's covenant, his commitment, his alliance with David, and Saul's anger burned against Jonathan. And he said to him, you son of a perverse, rebellious woman. I always chuckle at that. That's Saul's wife he's talking about, a perverse and rebellious woman. I think they may have been having marriage problems at the time. That would stress the guy out too. A perverse and rebellious woman. Do I not know that you are choosing the son of Jesse to your own shame and to the shame of your mother's nakedness? I think part of the conflict between Saul and his wife was concerning David. I think Saul had some jealousy about his wife's feelings towards David. And a guy can get pretty touchy about stuff like that. For as long as the son of Jesse lives on the earth, neither you nor your kingdom will be established. Therefore now send and bring him to me, for he must surely die. Saul knew that Jonathan and David were not going to be able to be compatible. They could not live together. He's like, as long as David's alive, then you will never be king. And this was Saul's goal in life, was to hand over the kingship to his son Jonathan. And he realized as long as David's there, that wasn't going to happen. The last time they get together, the last time they meet, is 1 Samuel 23. 15 through 17. David became aware that Saul had come out to seek his life while David was in the wilderness of Ziph at Horesh. So David's running from Saul, like normal, and Jonathan, Saul's son, arose and went to David at Horesh and encouraged him in God. Can you imagine how angry Saul would have been to realize that Jonathan can just walk up to David? I mean, Saul is begging everyone, if anyone knows where David is, and if you're holding out information from me about where David is, I'm going to kill you. And then his own son just goes to talk to David because he knows exactly where he is. So he went to David at Horesh and encouraged him in God. Thus he said to him, do not be afraid, because the hand of Saul my father will not find you. And you will be king over Israel, and I will be next to you. And Saul my father knows that also. You can see Jonathan's dream. He loved David so much, and he wanted him to be king, and he had no jealousy at all. He said, I would love to see you rule over Israel, and I'll be your right-hand man. And we can finally spend time together. Now, I've got a best friend, and there were only very short parts of our life where we actually got to hang out together. Most of the time, it was long distance. We were an ocean away. And even now, he's living in Canada, the other side of Canada even. It's a 24-hour drive to get there. So thank God for the internet, for phones. But we never got to be together, really, as friends, very rarely. And David and Jonathan, he was just yearning for the time when we can actually serve God together. You can be king, and I'll be your right-hand man, and life is going to be awesome. It's all Jonathan ever wanted. We know that that wasn't to be. We know that it wasn't much longer after this that Saul fought a battle against the Philistines, and he died. But not only Saul, but his sons as well. And I've always looked at Jonathan's death as a great tragedy. I think, God, why? Why didn't you allow them to have that time together? Why didn't you allow David and Jonathan to reign together? What a power couple they would have been. What an amazing thing they could have accomplished for God. But as I'm thinking about this sermon, this passage, this friendship came to me to remind me that maybe it wouldn't have been that way. Maybe Jonathan's death actually had a purpose. Maybe Jonathan would not have been that strong ally for David. Now, I agree with C.S. Lewis when Lewis says, what would have happened doesn't exist. We don't know what would have happened. But we do know that everything God does has a purpose. And if you can just imagine in your minds, what if the same spirit that had gone to afflict Saul was also gone to afflict Jonathan? We know this was a maddening spirit. This was a spirit that went to afflict Saul, and it changed his mind. It made him think thoughts that weren't correct. And Saul's battle against this spirit was won when he would call David in, and David would play on his 10-stringed instrument, and he would sing, and he would praise the Lord, and that spirit would have to leave. This is a weapon that we have. David very much understood that praising God is a weapon. In fact, 1 Chronicles 25, it lists his officers of his army. And the position in his army was praising God. Moreover, David and the commanders of the army set apart for the service some of the sons of Asaph and Heman and of Jeduthun who were to prophesy with lyres and harps and cymbals. David understood that praising God is not only a weapon, it's a spiritual weapon. I mean, aren't we grateful for all the work that these folks put in to their craft, to praising God with their music, and they lead us in worship? But you don't have to put this whole production together to praise God. And it even is calling it prophecy. You are speaking forth what's true about God. You are speaking his words. And it is a high calling to praise God. And God gives you that as a tool. And it is an offensive spiritual weapon that cannot be denied by the enemy. Now, the Bible tells us, resist the enemy and he will flee from you. But you know, right before that, it says, draw near to God and he will draw near to you. That is just as powerful and effective as resisting the enemy. And if we focus constantly on resisting the enemy, resisting the flesh, resisting sin, you're going to have a very tortured life. But if you focus on drawing near to God and he will draw near to you, if you focus on your real goal, your real purpose in life, which is to praise him and to be a powerful force within the kingdom, then all those other things kind of fall by the wayside. You're not constantly saying, God, I'm trying so hard not to sin, because you are accomplishing something that's awesome and powerful and good. And if you can praise God with the 10-string harp, with your imperfect voice, with my imperfect voice, then the enemy has to flee. This is a weapon that God used David to perform, to use in Saul's battle against the demon. And we don't know what would have happened, but I'm sure that the enemy had designs on Jonathan as well. And we also know that after David became king, one of Saul's sons, Ishbosheth, did fight David for the kingdom. So can you imagine the pressures that would have been put on Jonathan? He had every good intention. But when that power is actually offered to a person, who knows what happens? People change. Amen. It may have been mercy for God to take Jonathan at that time, despite all the hopes that they had of ruling the kingdom together and being this wonderful time of just enjoying each other, of enjoying power and peace. It may have been mercy. David loved Solomon or Saul and Jonathan, not just Jonathan. When he heard news that they had both died, that all of Saul's sons had died, or most of them, in 2 Samuel chapter 1, verse 23, he sang a song for them, and a part of it is Saul and Jonathan, beloved and pleasant in their life, and in their death they were not parted. They were swifter than eagles. They were stronger than lions. This is their eulogy. David is just mourning the death of Saul and Jonathan. But it's quite possible. We know that God has a purpose in everything he does, and we know that even something as tragic as the death of Jonathan, and you think, what did he ever do? How could that possibly have lined up with God's plans? But we don't know what the other plans were. Jonathan was never tempted to break his oath to David. He never did break his oath to David. He stayed faithful. He did not have that challenge that Hezekiah had. This is how these two stories are related. That in death is not always the worst thing that can happen to you. Sometimes being delivered from death, it would have been better for us to accept from God that this is what he has for me. God, you know the future and I don't. Now, I don't want anyone to misunderstand. If you are sick, if you are dying, it is always a good thing to ask God to raise you up, to ask God to give you some more time so that you can praise him, so that you can honor him. But it is not acceptable for you to turn your face to the wall and weep bitterly. I understand. I'm human too. I get it. But for us to take something that horrible that's happening to us, difficult that's happening to us, and shake our fist at God and say, God, I deserve better than this, that is blasphemy. We deserve worse than this, is really what we deserve. So anything that we get from God, we need to be able to trust Him. Definitely pray, definitely go to war and ask God and try to participate with Him in some amazing things like healing. It's a wonderful time. But some things are above us. Some things we don't ever get to know. Like Jonathan, we don't know what would have happened. And I believe that one of God's purposes in the story of Hezekiah is to show us what can potentially happen when our prayers are answered. So that there are times when our prayers are not answered, and we will say, God, I trust you. I don't always want you to answer my prayers. You know better than I do. And I submit this to you, Lord. I beg you for it. I passionately, Jesus, even when he was in the garden, he said, Lord, if there's any possible way, let this cup pass from me. Not my will, but yours be done. God didn't even answer all of Jesus' prayers. Understand that. And it was a good thing. Romans 9, verse 20 and 21. Who are you, O man, who answers back to God? The thing molded will not say to the molder, why did you make me like this, will it? Or does not the potter have a right over the clay to make from the same lump one vessel for honorable use and another for common use? We have been made by God in a certain way. And we can do things to try to improve ourselves. We need to be learning. We need to try to keep this piece of meat going as long as we can and make it fit. But there are some things, if you're a man, you're a man. If you're a woman, you're a woman. And you can't change those things. Some people have lost limbs. Some people are sick. Some people are in pain. And sometimes those things can't be changed. And we ask God. We ask God for healing and relief and comfort. But he has made us in a certain way. And it's easy to look at the things that are made for honorable use and be jealous of that. Say, I wish I was something more presentable. But which of those two things gets used more? The one for honorable use or the one for common use? You got plates in your house that you set out of the table when you're home. Maybe even a paper plate. It gets used one time. And that's you feel like it's a pretty dishonorable use. But it gets used. And every time the paper plate is used, everyone rejoices because we don't have to do dishes. We can just throw it away. And then you got the common place that maybe they just break. That's okay. There's another one. Pull it out. The life is short. That's fine. But those are the ones that get used every single day. And then you got the plates that are over in the china cabinet that are 100 years old. And you think the plates in the cupboard are jealous of those? They just sit there for hundreds of years. And they'll never even be used ever again because you would pull them out at Thanksgiving. But since they're 100 years old, they can't feed us anymore. Those aren't even good for Thanksgiving. So they just stay in the china cabinet forever. And you're going to hand it off to one of your daughters one day. And it'll stay in their china cabinet forever. So which would you rather be? Made for honorable use or common use? You would rather be what God made you to be. Because we need both of those things. We need every single person that's here. God made you for a purpose. And you don't know whether you're going to have 100 years in this life to serve God. Or whether you won't even survive the womb when you're conceived. And every single one of those people has a purpose from God. And it doesn't matter if you live 0 days, you live 0 days, or you live 100 years. 100 years from now, we're all in the same place. We're all in the grave. And we belong to a very select, a very rare group of people in the world. Everyone who can hear me today belongs to a very select group of people, which is people who are alive. Because almost all the people in the world who have ever been born are dead. And there are just a very few of us who are alive. And you don't know how long that's going to be. You don't know if you have another 15 years. You don't know if you have another 15 minutes. Amen. In 100 years, we're all going to be in the same place. And when God calls our name and says, it's time for you. And we need to be able to say, God, I trust you. If you're running a marathon, I used to run a little bit, and not ever a competitive race, but just imagine you feel like you've got another 10, 15, 20 miles to go, and you're running, and then suddenly there's the finish line. It's right there. I mean, would you really say, no, I want to run another 20 miles. I don't feel like I'm done yet. I prepared for more. Or would you say, oh, there's the finish line right there. I'm done. When God says, well done, my faithful servant, that means you're done. It's a good thing. I want you to look at death as actually a finishing and accomplishing, and not saying, God, please save me from death. Please give me another 15 years. Please heal me from this sickness. Because when he does that, we need to trust his purposes. Ecclesiastes 2, verses 15 and 16, talks about the legacy. Solomon has an amazing legacy, but he may not have known it at the time. Well, if you read Ecclesiastes, he's like, who knows what's going to happen after us? I said to myself, as is the fate of the fool, it will also befall me. We're all going to end up in the same place. Some gravestones are higher than others, but the body is all the same level. We're all the same. Why then have I been extremely wise? So I said to myself, this too is vanity. This is fruitlessness. There's no lasting remembrance of the wise man as with the fool, inasmuch as in the coming days all will be forgotten, and the wise man and the fool will die alike. So Tim kind of made this illustration to us a few weeks ago about how we remember some of the people who are four generations, your great-grandparents. Not many of us can name all eight of our great-grandparents. And my grandmother, some of my kids knew her. They didn't know her very well. She was in the nursing home, and my wife was very faithful to bring the kids out to see her in the nursing home. At that stage of her life, they probably saw her more than I did. But how many stories are they going to tell their kids about my grandmother? Probably none. They might tell them a few stories about my parents, but certainly not about my grandparents. So four generations, five generations later, you're forgotten. And Solomon assumed this was going to happen to him too. But God had different purposes for him. He said, and God had him write this in Scripture. And Scripture, which is eternal, never dies. Solomon was actually mistaken about this. He said, nobody's going to remember me. There will be no lasting remembrance of the wise man as with the fool. Well, God actually did use his Scripture, which never passes away, to help us to remember Solomon. So we don't know. We really don't know what of the things that we're doing God is going to use to be our legacy. We don't know how history is going to remember us, if at all. Even Solomon is wrong about that. And a more modern example is Abe Lincoln was wrong about that as well. Now, if you wonder why that Lincoln is there, I was looking for pictures of Abe Lincoln to put with his slide, and then, of course, that picture came up too. And then Peter was with me, and he said, Dad, is that the car that Abe Lincoln drove? So I said, all right, we'll leave it in. But actually, anyway, if you look at all the similarities between Abe Lincoln and John F. Kennedy, one of the many, is John Kennedy was shot while he was driving a Lincoln. Anyway, he wasn't driving, he was riding in a Lincoln. And, yeah, it was a Ford, that's right. And Lincoln was shot in Ford's Theater. Yep. So, during the Gettysburg Address, which is probably the most famous speech in Western civilization, Lincoln said something. He said, the world will little note nor long remember what we say here, but it can never forget what they did here. Meanwhile, that's what everyone does, is remember what Lincoln said there. So Lincoln didn't even remember accurately predict his legacy. It's interesting that this speech was about 4 minutes long, and if you read it, you can read it in much less than 4 minutes. So you might lead to the conclusion that Lincoln was kind of a slow talker, which may have been true. And the reason he said this, I believe, is because he came after a speaker who spoke for about 2 hours on the Gettysburg battlefield. And so Lincoln was like, I'm just going to give this nice, sweet, simple thing, and this is kind of a dig, throwing shade at the guy ahead of him who said, the world will little note nor long remember what we say here. Sit down, son, pretty much, as Lincoln is president, and I'll show you how to make a speech that everyone's going to remember. But he didn't think this would be remembered, and of course it was. This is the thing, even I was never required to memorize it, but I remember a generation before me, all the school kids had to memorize this speech. And Lincoln thought that no one would ever remember it. He did have one speech that was better, at least one. But at the time, all the reporters that were there, they said, this speech is so good, I'm not going to write it down. I'm just going to sit here and listen. Someone else can write it down. Someone else can get the scoop. I'm listening. And not a single reporter at that speech wrote anything down. And we assume that that was the best speech he ever had, and there's no record of it. But Lincoln was a good speaker, and we don't know what our legacy will be. But we do know that it's good for us to exit the world. We do know that living forever would be a bad thing. One of the simplest things that I see every day, especially this time of year, is we see the grass growing, and it gets taller, and it gets kind of stemmy, and the quality is a little less, but it produces seed, and that seed falls down. And as the grass dies, it lays more seed down, and then new grass grows up. And if a person lived forever, this new generation that's always coming behind would never have a chance to flourish and thrive. The old actually does have to go away for the new to have a chance to show itself what it can do. The new has to have a chance to lead. The new has to have a chance to be responsible for things so that they can flourish and that they can actually achieve the things that God has asked them to do. They can't always be looking up at somebody. And it's interesting that I'm 46 now, and I'm starting to see the people in my generation take positions of leadership. And it was strange when I look back at the people I knew when I was young and how many of them are like fire chief, police chief, pastors of churches. They're all in positions of authority in their industry, top of their industry. And at first, for a little while, I thought, wow, I really knew some pretty important people when I was back in the day. And then you think, no, that's just the stage of life. That's what 40s and 50s and 60s, you're supposed to be doing those things. You're supposed to be in charge of things. But if the people lived to 300 years old, 400 years old, we would never get a chance to take over. And so not only is it good for the old to pass away and for the young that the old passes away, it's good for the old too. I mean, there's going to come a day when I get to pass this on, when I get to say, watch my children take hold of it and run with it and accomplish things. And if I never was able to let go of it, then I would never have that joy of seeing my children walk with their own decisions in the truth. Because I would always be holding on and saying, God, give me another 15 years. Help me to stay here longer. But for me to say, okay, this is the stage of life where I release it, and I get to watch this this passive growth where I don't have to work at it anymore. I can just see the legacy. I can see it grow, what you've created, God, what you've used me to do. And even if the world is just wonderful, death would still be a good thing. But the world isn't wonderful. Amen. The world's a pretty horrible place, honestly. Most of you guys in here, you look really nice, and it's easy to assume that you have a good life. But as I was telling the kids yesterday, you drive down the road and look at these houses. So many of these houses, there's strife in the marriage. There's child abuse. There's huge problems. There's alcoholism. Amen. Every one of these, not every one of these houses, but so many of them, they look nice. They've got nice landscaping. The siding is good. The roof is good. But inside the house, there's rottenness. Amen. This is the normal condition of life. And if we think of this is what happens in the United States, where things are good, where we still have a strong Christian influence, what happens in places like India? What happens in places like Africa? Where all the houses, almost all the houses, you know, a pastor in India, he told me 80% of the pastors in India, Christian pastors, beat their wives. 80%. Is it a bad thing that the wicked don't live forever? Lord Acton said, power corrupts, and absolute power corrupts absolutely. If we continued to live, wicked people continued to live, their power would only grow, and they would become more and more and more wicked. It's not an accident that Manasseh was the longest reigning king, and he was also the most wicked. If you start to go off the wrong way, the longer you're there, that exponential curve, it gets pretty bad at the end. So many of these dictators, aren't we so glad that Mugabe, the dictator of Zimbabwe, didn't live forever? He reigned until into his 80s, and everyone's wondering, when is this guy going to die? And he finally did, thank God. And that nation is still pretty bad, but at least Mugabe is not the dictator anymore. There are so many wicked people in this world, and death is a gift to us. Job actually talked about this. Now, of course, Job was speaking from a position of extreme discouragement and depression at the time. This was the lowest. He'd been at the heights, and within a month, probably, he fell all the way down to a lower position than any of us have ever been in. So we consider that, but he was still speaking the truth. He was jealous at this point of the people who had never survived the womb. See, I wish I had never been born, for now I would have lain down and been quiet. I would have slept and I would have been at rest with kings and counselors of the earth who rebuilt ruins for themselves, or with princes who had gold who were filling their houses with silver. Like a miscarriage which is hidden, I would not be, as infants that never saw the light. There in the grave, the wicked cease from raging, and there the wicked are at rest. The prisoners are at ease together. They do not hear the voice of the taskmaster. The small and the great are there. The slave is free from his master. This is the normal condition of people in one of these situations. Slavery, in prison, people who are weary, the wicked. It is mercy from God that life doesn't last forever. Not just that we have a hope after death, but also because even in this life, we can thank God that there is such a thing called death. I hope that when that comes to me, when that day comes, and I'm planning for it to be a long time down the road, but I hope that I can meet that day well. I hope that I can meet that day in humility. I hope that I can meet that day with reverence and respect to God and say, if you say I'm done, Lord, then I trust you. And I'm not going to weep for the lost years. I'm going to say, God, I thank you for the time that I had. I thank you for what you've accomplished in my life and what you're going to continue to accomplish with what you used me to do after I'm gone. And I trust you. Whether I get to see that or not, I trust you. In fact, this, I believe, is certainly the last great work we have to do, but it is, in some ways, the highest and best purpose that we can show each other, how to walk through that time. There is a lot of things that you're going to have to go through in life. We often talk about how hard life is, and that's normal for life to be hard. But not everyone goes through a divorce. Not everyone has to bury their child. Not everyone has to have an alcoholic spouse. Not everyone has to have cancer. You will have hard things in life, but we don't know exactly what they are. There is going to be something, however, that's so hard for you that it's going to kill you. So I'm predicting that. I'm a prophet, right? I'm going to say that one day something is going to kill you. And every one of us is going to have to go through that. And to show someone how to go through cancer, that's awesome, because there are a lot of people coming behind you who are going to learn from your example. To show them how to go through a divorce, a lot of people are going to learn from you. To show people how to go through death, to do that well, everybody can watch you do that. And in that day, that is a job that I want to do really well. And it's not always easy. And sometimes it can be very, very difficult. And it's easy for me as a healthy 46-year-old person to tell people how to go through death. But I know that there are people who can hear and will hear who are very close to that themselves and even have heard, maybe not a prophecy from God, but know they can feel it in their bones and in their body. They're saying death is not far off. And I want to encourage you that instead of just saying, I'm useless now, I'm a dead man walking, to say I have something to accomplish. I can actually die well. This is a huge work that you can do for God, because people are watching. And death isn't the end. Death isn't such a horrible thing. I don't want to romanticize it, but it is often, we fear it. And we see it as a consequence of sin, and it is. It's in the world because of sin. But it's a gift from God. Ephesians 2, 4 through 7, but God, being rich in mercy, because of his great love with which he loved us, even while we were dead in our transgressions, he made us alive together with Christ, right? We're always trying to put this body to death. And one of these days, it's actually going to die the last time, and that'll be a good day. He made us alive in Christ, and by grace you have been saved, and raised us up with him, and seated us with him in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus. These are all awesome things that happen to us in this life. We actually get to sit spiritually on God's throne with him. And the whole reason for this gospel, this good news, is so that in the ages to come, he might show the surpassing riches of his grace in kindness toward us in Christ Jesus. The things that are going to be happening are in the future, in our afterlife, after the grave, are actually going to be better than the things that God has given us now, which are amazing. This good news that God has given us, he's like, this is all just an illustration. This is so that he can show the surpassing riches in the ages to come. So it's a down payment. It's a foretaste. This life is fleeting. This life is... it's so important for us to do things well here because it has eternal consequences. Even the small things that you might feel like, oh, this is just fleshly. This is just in the world. But it actually has eternal consequences. God is watching, and there are eternal rewards. There are things that God is offering us because of our obedience. And by the way, that demon that's coming to you to try to get you to sin, that demon has victory when you sin. It's not all those things that is going wrong in your life right now. You say, man, I stubbed my toe. Why did I have to do that exact the same moment that I found out that the engine is blown, and which is happening at the same time that it's raining and I can't get the harvest in, and the same time this cow just died, and now the tiniest thing sends you over to the edge, right? Stub your toe. That's the thing that makes you blaspheme. God says, God tells us that the battle is actually in our hearts. It's in our souls, and to keep us from sinning. And so it's not that the engine can get fixed, or that this cow can live, or that all these other things that are afflicting you can be solved. The battle is in your soul, and all those things can pass away, all those things you can lose, as long as you keep your testimony, which you do by praising God. And if you do that, you may feel like you didn't accomplish anything, but you kept your testimony, and God sees that. He sees what is done in secret, and he'll reward you, and he's got something waiting for you. And you can be encouraged that as you die, there are so many stories of people who have so much joy in their heart because they can see glory. It's like this world fades away. This world gets more and more dim, and they're seeing glory on the other side, and they're saying, it is worth it all. And it can be such an enrapturing experience to actually go through the process of dying. My mother has been blessed to sit at the bedside of many people who died, both of her parents, some of her grandparents, her husband, and it's been a ministry of hers to minister to people who are terminal, and she's often sat at their bedside and been with them as they expire, and she tells all kinds of stories, and she's not afraid of death because there's rapture in death. As you see the other side, as you see the veil that is before our eyes that keeps us from seeing what's real, that veil gets thinner and thinner, and you can see the sails being drawn up, and the ship goes out into the sea, and this world gets farther and farther away. And you turn away from this world, and you say, I don't mourn the passing of myself from this world. I'm going to look to what's good. And you see the veil drawn up, and you see the sun rising, and you see the far green country. You see the inheritance that you get to go to, and you see with your real eyes, and you see with your spiritual eyes, and you hear the trumpet call, and you rise to meet Christ in the air. All this happens at the moment of death. Amen. And in this moment, I'm looking forward to that. I don't know how I'm going to handle it when the time comes, but I want to try to give you some resources you can use so that when that time comes for you, hopefully that you will have been anticipating that with joy, even to say that my race is done and I get to walk down my inheritance. Unanswered prayers are sometimes a good thing. And death, God knows our days. He knows the end from the beginning. He knows the moment of our death. And he hasn't told any of us that it's going to be 15 years from now, but he knows when that is. And when that time comes and he touches you and he said, you're done, you can rejoice. Say, God, I trust you. This is a good thing. I offer everything else that I would have accomplished. I offer it to you. Should we pray? Lord, you've given us everything we need for life and godliness. You have been a constant help to us in times of struggle. You have shown yourself worthy. You have shown yourself to be a friend in time of need. And so many people, when they cross the river,
that all of us are going to have to cross. So many have testified in that moment that you are walking with them, you are carrying them, and you are keeping them from being overwhelmed by the flood. And we trust that for us, Lord. And we trust, we ask, as much, Lord, as we ask to be healed, as much as we ask to be used by you, as much as we ask that our legacy will be fruitful and bear fruit in your kingdom, we also ask, Lord, that we would not fail at the final test, that we would give you glory when everything is going wrong, that you would give us the gift of being able to be the example to those behind us that finishing the race, if we don't have a strong kick at the end, Lord, we could fail at the end. But we want to be an example. And I ask also for those many that are on my mind right now who are struggling, who are some of them even gasping maybe for a breath, and some of them, I ask that you give them peace. I know some of them, many of them, are asking for a healing. They're asking for a touch from you. They're asking to be used by you. And we join them in that, Lord. We join them because we love them too, and we will miss them. And we know what can be accomplished through them. And so we ask you in Jesus' name that you would raise them up, that you would give them new life, that you would give them joy, you would allow them to praise you in the flesh, use this body to praise you and give glory to you among the nations. But Lord, if it is their time, if it is the end, Lord, then I ask that you would give them peace, and that you would help them to enjoy looking forward, not so much back in this world, but looking forward to your kingdom. Lord, you are worthy to be praised. And any time when we get discouraged, Lord, I ask that we would die with praise on our lips. If we would live with praise on our lips, Lord, may we die with praise on our lips. We can love you, Lord, with everything in our bodies. We are looking so much forward to praising you with the host of heaven, with voices that do not falter and with fingers that know their instruments. And we're looking forward to praising you with understanding, with our eyes wide open, seeing you in all your glory and being like you because we see you as you are. This is our hope and our passion, Lord. And as we approach the end of this life, we get so much closer. I thank you, Lord, for the examples you've given us. We trust you that when our prayers are not answered, we trust you that you have a purpose. But we do ask you, Lord, we thank you for the encouragement that we are allowed to ask. And so we do that, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. If there are any who would like prayer, we'd love to spend time with you praying for you. We've asked some people to come and be ready to do that. Normally we say go and fulfill the charge that you've been given, but I hope you don't pass this week. I hope God has a long, long life for you. This is a message that you need to put into practice a long time from now.
I hope you've enjoyed this. To hear other messages, go to facebook.com/GCF Church or youtube.com/GCF Church. You may also follow Georgetown Christian Fellowship with our app. Go to either iOS or the Play Store for Android and search for Word Server. That's one word, Word Server. And install the free application. There you will get all of our messages, including streaming capabilities.